call the council meeting to order. Please be seated. All right. A motion to adopt the minutes of the open council meeting held on February the 15th, 2016. Moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, opposed, and carried. We have a delegation tonight. It's the Burnaby Arts Council in regard to a new public art gallery for the city of Burnaby. The speakers are Bill Thompson, president, and David Handelman, director. All those in favor, opposed, carried. Thank you. I'm just finding their materials. You have 10 minutes, gentlemen.
Thank you. Can you hear me? Yeah. Hello, Mayor and Council. My name is Bill Thompson. Okay. My name is Bill Thompson. I live at 4660 West Lawn Drive in Burnaby, and I'm the president of the board for the Burnaby Arts Council and a volunteer at the Arts Council.
And my name is David Handelman. I live at 3768 Triumph Street in Burnaby, and I'm on the Burnaby Arts Council and involved with the committee that's working towards building a new art gallery.
So, Council, today we're here to present a little report on our work regards to a new arts council, our new gallery for the city. The purpose really of that report is to ask specifically that this council pass a motion that their planning department conducts a study on the feasibility, desirability of building a new public art gallery for the city of Burnaby. That's the goal of our report and the goal of this meeting tonight, actually. I'd just like to maybe start off by giving you a little vision as to how the Arts Council sees the potential or what a new art gallery might look like. And we have a vision statement toward that end. We want to create a new space for the Burnaby Art Gallery now and for the future that will address the physical and environmental limitations of the current building. It will adequately house and conserve the city's significant art collection and thereby attract more opportunities to build the collection and make it more accessible for viewing, studying, and researching. The space, by meeting international museum standards, will create increased options to attract important traveling exhibitions, to create exhibitions of greater diversity and size, and to expand the visual arts engagement programming and education for artists, residents, and visitors alike. The new space will become an important cultural destination at the geographic heart of the Lower Mainland, providing new economic benefits for the future prosperity of the city, and it will also be a significant architectural statement, adding to the urban vibrancy of our city. That's our vision, and we believe in that vision. So just to give you, I'm not going to read out obviously the report. I believe you all have it, or you've had it. Hopefully you've had a chance to look through it. I'll just give you a brief statement here about how we got to this place. As you're aware, I think we were here almost a year ago, or we were here last year, and we were also appeared before the Parks, Recreation, and Commission about this topic. So we've been working on this for 3 or 4 years in a volunteer situation. Last year, in 2015, we, after kind of many attempts to get the ear of the council, we decided to just go out and see what was out there. So we had joined the mayor's walk, Jane's Walk, last summer along the new Beresford Avenue Arts Corridor. That was a great opportunity because the mayor was able to show us that this is a great new possible arts district with much public art to be installed, and it looked like a fantastic asset, a new asset for the city. We also noted that time that this was an important location in relation to Civic Square, which is also, we feel, the potential new location for a public art gallery. And really, to make a new arts district work, we feel it's very important that it be anchored to such a facility. So we like that vision that the city has put forward for that area. And following up on that, we, after a kind of frustration with dealing with various presentations, which we tried to raise the awareness of the issue, we approached the city staff and asked them, well, what do we have to do in the planning process to make this move forward? So we, after we met with them, we suggested that we first perhaps hold a public meeting to get a sense of, gauge the public support for such a project. So we held such a public meeting. It was held on November 3rd in 2015, and we had a, included a lively panel discussion, public input for over 100 people, and we saw that there was strong support from that event. The gallery was a priority for many people. They felt that the current gallery had some serious problems, and they wanted to see this project move ahead. We also met with the director of the Parks, Recreation, and Culture Department, and in that meeting, he suggested the next planning steps may be, in fact, for us to come to you with a motion, trying to get the City Council to understand our vision, the reasons we seek a new gallery, and to request that this City Council maybe make a motion that they could be directed to create a proper study on the topic. So that's kind of what has happened in recent past. We also, in our report, and hopefully, again, you've had a chance to look through that, we've identified a lot of the issues we see with the current gallery. We've addressed what we see as some of the potential social, economic, and educational benefits from building a new facility. We've actually identified which is our preferred location, which is Civic Square. And we've also had the chance to go out and look at some other nearby communities which have new purpose-built art galleries. We looked at three specific ones. We looked at the Reach Gallery in Abbotsford, the Polygon Gallery, which is a proposal in North Vancouver, and we looked at the Light Catcher Gallery in Bellingham, Washington. All three of these spaces are quite beautiful. They are large contemporary facilities, and they have been built with a combination of funding arrangements, but they also are great assets new to those communities. They, and these are communities that have smaller populations than Burnaby. So it can be done. We believe in the vision, and at this point, I think I'd just like to pass it on to David, who's going to give you a few more comments about our project.
Yes, just have a few comments. Thank you, members of council, for hearing our delegation. And just want to add that, you know, we know Burnaby is growing. There's more and more people. It's more and more urban all the time. In fact, I know that Mayor Corrigan was at Whole Foods recently, the opening, and he was quoted as saying that the existence of the Whole Foods gives evidence to the fact that Burnaby is becoming an exciting urban community. I also know that I believe Mayor Corrigan supports the, more office towers for Burnaby, you know, and along with other Lower Mainland mayors, because you know they want the ability to have the population and the work and the amenities spread around. So we think that the art gallery, if we can get a new art gallery in Burnaby, it would be a perfect addition to the amenities of Burnaby and increase the livability, the activity, and the economic opportunities in Burnaby. The last thing I want to say is we do know that Burnaby has wonderful facilities, dozens and dozens of soccer fields and skating arenas and senior centers, golf, outdoor swimming pools, indoor pools, and you know we think that it's time for Burnaby to at least initiate a study to see what we can find out about the needs and the possibilities for building a new art gallery in Burnaby. And the very last thing I'd like to say is we're not asking for any money. We're just asking for the planning department that this council should pass a motion to direct the planning department to conduct a feasibility and desirability study. So those are my comments. Did you want to say anything?
Well, actually, those last comments, I think, are the conclusion, because that's what we're here for tonight, is we'd like to see some movement by the council and maybe to take this proposal seriously and direct your own department to do a proper study. You know, up to now, we've been volunteers working on the outside, putting together our own research and data and information, all in support of such a facility, but really it's going to need some leadership from this council to make it move forward. It's been a long battle to get to this point, and we appreciate, you know, your listening to our cause, so thank you.
Thank you, and thank you for the work that you've put in to date in getting the report together. I noted I was going through, and having been around for a long time, I couldn't help but note that you didn't mention that in 1987 there was a referendum. Did you not know about the referendum?
I don't think
knew the details enough, that's why it might have slipped through the chronicle. I believe...
There weren't a lot of details, as you lost. It was that simple.
We weren't here that time, so...
87, they put forward a referendum for the taxpayer to pay for an art gallery complex, performance center, library, and the referendum lost. And that was, in fact, the first year I was elected, was on that that referendum year. So I was kind of surprised, given the depth and breadth of the research that you'd done, that you'd missed that important part as a public referendum in regard to the issue. But
In relation to that, was that a referendum that was tied somewhat to some other park issues, I believe, at the time?
Referendum, no. It was a referendum purely in regard to that project, and it was put on the ballot and rejected by the electorate. And certainly, you know, we've heard this kind of recommendation before. One of the real difficulties, as you are probably aware, in doing something as important as an art gallery is whether or not there is federal and provincial funding for a gallery of that type, because to be successful, they have to be regionally significant to do what you've asked them to do, which is to have international exhibits, to be of highest museum standards. All of those things are part and parcel of having a facility like the one that's being planned now in Vancouver. And interestingly enough, there was never an opportunity for any city to be able to look at being the candidate for a provincially, federally funded art gallery, because I know many of the cities around the region would have loved to have fulfilled that role. But those kind of decisions are often made with only Vancouver in mind, because Vancouver is the center of the region as far as the corporate community is considers, as far as the federal and provincial government consider. And that's why major facilities like a new football stadium don't go into one of the suburban municipalities, or a new ice rink for hockey teams goes into Vancouver, not one of the suburban facilities. It's why brand new convention centers go into Vancouver twice. Both centers ended up in downtown Vancouver, and so immediately after there was the announcement of a potential gallery done by the private sector, that is a not-for-profit group, the provincial government came in with $50 million worth of funding and handed money over. Now, if you can deliver that, then you suddenly make these kind of projects interesting. You know, if there is federal, provincial money and in the kind of range where you're able to look at a facility that is going to be of international significance, of regional significance, then most municipalities will line up to try to be part of that process, particularly since in many cases is the provincial or federal government will be helping to pay the operating expenses for a facility like that, because it is part of the cultural and artistic background of our country, and therefore there is a desire to be able to protect those kind of things. Asking cities to take on those functions and do them, very difficult to be able to sustain and to be able to pay the operating expenses. It is oftentimes left to us to do minor facilities where we're able to serve local interests, to be able to showcase local art. Those are generally what's able to be accommodated in municipalities and has been in the past accommodated. And you look at, in our case, what we chose to do is we have Burnaby Village Museum, and we're subsidizing that to what, $1 million a year? $1 million a year of public money to keep the Burnaby Village Museum going and to contribute regionally as a city to protecting our heritage, which has been a very big item for us in the city. You'll note that we spent a lot of money in Deer Lake. In fact, I don't know what your budget is as the Arts Council, but it would probably be a lot more difficult to be able to cope with that if you weren't in a city building in our park, where we've attempted to protect all of those heritage houses along the waterfront. So you know, these are difficult. But I think it's fair enough for staff to respond and...
Can I respond, Mr. Mayor, to some of your comments?
Sure.
You know, we think that if a study is done, you know, that shows that there is a need and that would fit into the community, we think it's very possible that the private sector might get involved, or the federal government, or the provincial government. There is a gallery being constructed in North Vancouver right now, the Polygon Gallery, with significant contributions from the private sector. You know, we don't have the intention of competing with the Vancouver Art Gallery. That budget, I believe, is in the neighborhood of $300 to $400 million. The kind of gallery that we're talking about building here in Burnaby, we believe, based on the information from the other galleries that we've seen, would be anywhere from 10 to upwards $30-35 million. We have no intention of competing with Vancouver. At the same time, Burnaby has a brilliant collection of works on paper that deserves to be displayed. And as you may have noticed in the package of appendix, the Pendulum Gallery in downtown Vancouver recently showed a show totally devoted to Jack Shadbolt, which is from the Burnaby Art Collection Gallery. That's a great honor to show the great collection in Burnaby. And simply put, as far as I know, it can't be shown in Burnaby. There hasn't even been a show of Jack Shadbolt's works in many decades in Burnaby. And we don't have the ability to showcase our fine art collection and turn it into the tourist attraction and a cultural amenity that we think it could be. We certainly appreciate that it's an expensive thing to do, but Burnaby builds sports facilities, builds swimming pools. I don't know how profitable any of those things are. I guess I would just say that you know, if the city does approve a study, and if the study shows that it has a real viability, we believe that it's likely that some of the corporate people headquarters in Burnaby, amongst whom are the BD Group and PMC Sierra and Kodak and Creo and on and on, Burnaby and Ballard, Burnaby is home dozens and dozens of very successful, wealthy corporations, and we think if the city led the way, those corporations might come on board. So
you don't want to lead the way on this?
We don't want...
You want us to do it?
We need the city. We're volunteers. We are running...
That's always the way it is. Is it yes. Volunteers
and
are
we
the
would
ones
be,
to come
we
out
would
and
be
do
happy
it.
To participate in any study. In fact, we would like to see any study that occurs include members of the business community, members of the education community, members of the art community, of course, our present leadership of the art gallery, because it's their collection that we would hope to house, a variety of interest groups that we would hope would be part of any process that got that was taken up by our planning department.
I'm a little unclear too. I mean, the city builds libraries, the city builds other cultural facilities, community centers. Is there kind of a different perspective on a gallery as opposed to other cultural amenities in the community as to their value or investment opportunities?
I think a large amount of the effort that is put in by the city is trying to ensure that we're building a facility that will host a great many of our residents. And one of the biggest focuses we have is to be able to encourage broad range of uses. And certainly that's a high priority for us. Our libraries are among the best used in Canada. And we take great pride in looking after our ability to ensure people have access to knowledge. So yeah, it's a big factor. And it's a question of balancing a whole range of interests. But this isn't about participation. This is about viewing professional artists' work. That's what it's about. It's like going to a hockey game or played by professionals. It's to go and see people who are at the top of the game in order to enjoy the passive element of recreating. We're much more involved in the active part of it, reading, exercising, getting out and swimming, doing the things that people generally want to do as part of the recreation system. Cultural institutions have been fundamentally, for many, many, many years, the institutions that are promoted by your federal and provincial government, because they have the ability, the money, to be able to put those facilities into place. And they haven't been traditionally an area where cities take on the responsibility. So, you know, often you look to the private sector, to patrons of the arts, to be able to do it. But if you've got Beatty and Sierra and Ballard all lined up, I'm willing to listen, as maybe you can...
I believe they would likely take an interest if the city led the way. If David Handelman would call them up, they don't know who me. I have no ability to influence any of those people. I believe they would take an interest if the city led the way.
Right. Well, thank you, gentlemen. I appreciate it. Councillor Volko?
Thank you, Your Worship. Thanks very much for coming. Took great interest in reading your presentation. I attended your forum last year. It was well attended. I would be interested in seeing a response from our planning department into some of the issues that you've raised in here. I note that in your chronology, you started in 1967. This goes back, well, we're almost into 50 years next year. 1967, I think I was in grade 10. So predates my becoming involved in
it. I think that was 67 and 68, wasn't it?
Best years of my life were the best years of my life, as they say, were spent in grade 10. As a matter of fact, that's probably why I got expelled, and I wouldn't know that was SFU was responsible for that. But anyways, back to the issue at hand. And so I would be interested in seeing a response from our planning department in regards to this. In particular, I would like to see the comparisons that you made in regards to the three galleries that you did point out, one south of the line and the two that are here within the lower mainland. I think it would be as I say, I think it'd be worthy of the city to take a look at it. I mean, we're at 250,000 people now. We're growing by leaps and bounds, to the dismay of some and to the ardor of others. So this is another facility. I appreciate the fact that you are volunteers. I think it would be good in the report to have a reminder of exactly what the circumstances were in 87 in regards to the referendum and what occurred there. But I think what you're asking for is the city to be a catalyst, potentially, in spurring on the participation of the private sector. I don't know if they'd be there, but if the city puts forward a report, there may be some interest generated within the corporate community. Who knows? But again, I'd like to thank you for coming, and I see there's other speakers that would like to ask some questions. I would put forward a motion for our planning department to do what you asked.
I think, Councillor Volko, that the issue is one of whether or not council's going to respond to the issues they've raised, or whether we're going to move into a study. And it would be, the two are significantly different. Is going into a study would mean that we would have to designate resources into it. And council would have to make up a decision, make their mind up that this entered the capital budget, and or that we were going to plan to put it into the capital budget. So there's an issue of whether or not planning staff thinks this is an appropriate time to be considering this issue before we move into any kind of study. At least that would be my advice to council. Councillor Jordan.
Okay, I'm just trying to separate those two things. Thank you for the presentation, and I did enjoy reading it. And I guess I would support a motion that the staff do respond, you know, around some of the issues raised here. But I just have questions for my own self. So you really are focused on like a standalone, architecturally significant building on its own, and you don't mention that, for example, New Westminster just did their new Anvil Center, where they have Do you call it a gallery, or is it more of a museum that they have?
Multimedia center.
Yes, okay, and that, and combined with their archives and things, and their conference center and stuff, but you don't even mention that in your report. I wonder if, so you're really focused on a standalone gallery?
Well, we're not requesting a museum and a gallery, or a gallery and something else. We're asking for really a proper facility for the visual arts. That would best perhaps be served by a separate building. However, the Arts Council is very fluid on this. I mean, depending on what came out of a study, if there was architectural ideas that were a combination kind of facility, we're very flexible on that. We're not locked into it be a wholly, a single building. It's the space needs that have to be met that we're concerned about.
And I guess that's what I would like a staff report to focus on is, like, numbers get thrown around, costs get thrown around, opportunities for private sector funding or whatever, but at the end of the day, the operating funds is what I'm concerned about the long time. You can get a big fat grant for capital expenditures and things, but then who runs the place, right? So that's and what kind of admissions are you going to have to charge in order for you to have to, to pay the salaries of the people that work there, all that kind of thing. So I'm concerned about that. And then the other, but the other piece I am concerned about is that the current gallery, its life cycle too. How old is the building? 100 years old. And we're spending quite a bit of money this year just fixing the deck. So I think that also needs to be a part of what we look at is just what is the life expectancy of the current gallery space, and we know it's not adequate. We understand that for storage reasons and fiscal reasons, and it's not handicapped accessible and all of those things. So I understand there's limitations there too. So I think it's something that that we need to get reported back to on a formal basis of just what we think the life expectancy of that building is and how much money might we be looking at having to spend on that just to make it up to speed, right? So,
just in response to your first part of your comments, Ms. Jordan, Councilor Jordan, regarding what it should look like, we don't know what it should look like. We have great confidence in the planning department, the feasibility and desirability that it might come up with something totally different from what we had in mind. And the experts, the talented people that we have, in conjunction with, we hope, input from as many sources as possible, hopefully we'll come up with a concept that meets the needs of the visual arts community and perhaps incorporates other things such as our incorporate in the Anvil Center. We don't know. We're open. We truly are.
Thank you. Thanks very much for all the work that you've put into this.
I'm interested, so we're not going to have to spend more money on Separately Mansion. This is from the chair of the Heritage Commission.
No, that's what I'm saying. We are.
But whether we've got an art gallery or not in there, I don't think you're going to indicate that we don't do that work.
But the parts of the cost of the space having to do with the public access, the gallery space, the storage of the things are over and above what it would take if it was some other purpose.
Well, exactly. And what other purpose?
Yeah. Don't know.
Exactly.
Not on the Parks Commission. They're the ones who are in charge of what happens to it.
I just look after the walls.
Councillor Calandino, you had a question.
Well, if he needs to respond, I can wait.
Okay.
Do I talk or does he?
No, go ahead.
Oh, okay. Thank you for the presentation, and I've heard some of this when I was on the Parks Commission. In fact, I heard just about all of it. And the fact is that I don't know that I have an aversion towards an art gallery. I think it would be a marvelous thing. I'm just wondering whether we have the population base to support that. So my issue here is the sustainability of an art gallery in a small community like Burnaby, especially if Vancouver manages to build the $350 million art gallery there. You gave a lot of examples here, but all these examples are privately funded, mostly. Now, when you said you want staff to do the study and staff can approach businesses in the community, we generally don't ask staff to go and approach businesses for funding. That's usually done by non-private organization, and I take that the Arts Council is a non-private, and if we don't send David Handelman to ask for support, we ask the Arts Council to go out and find support in the private sector. And if there is enough support, and I don't mean just in the capital cost of it, but in the maintenance and in the running of the joint, because the big expenses would come after you have to maintain staff and quite a bit of it if you want to make it successful. So I think that legwork needs to be done by you, the Arts Council, and when you can present to us that there is a business case to perhaps the city move on, and even if the city has to put a good portion of the capital cost, we might be able to consider that.
Well, I guess I would say, I think you maybe said that these other buildings are funded privately. I believe you said at the outset. The Abbotsford Gallery is publicly funded.
And now successfully.
The North Van Gallery is a combination of public and private, and the Bellingham Gallery is a combination of public and private. So there are different models and different ways that this can happen. Regarding whether we could produce a business case, we don't have the expertise and we don't have the money to hire a person who could do that or a company, but if council chose to give the Burnaby Arts Council several tens of thousands of dollars, which is probably what it would cost to develop a business case, then that's a possibility. It's just we literally can't do that. We don't have the talent or the expertise. Well, we have ideas, but we don't have that expertise.
I'm not sure what you consider by expertise. It needs desire by members of the council to go out and make connection with the business community and sell the project to them. I think they would, from experience.
We did go to the Burnaby Board of Trade, and they told us, well, see what happens when you go to council. They didn't want to
stick their neck out
at this point.
Okay.
They were reluctant to do anything until this step happened. That's what they told us.
Okay.
Councillor Johnson.
Thank you. I just have a question. I notice in your proposal you have a map of the Civic Square with the library on one side and a proposed facility on the left. Are you married to Metrotown?
No.
So you'd be okay if it was in Lougheed or Edmonds or Lougheed Highway?
We're suggesting that if we were asked our preference, it would be Civic Square. However, we have realized that there are potential sites, and obviously if the city is involved in contributing land, then that would dictate what's available and so forth. So, no, we're not welded to one location only.
If I had my crystal ball out and I looked at the concept of the Civic Square, I would say that's almost non-possibility. That site was intended for a facility at one point, but it sat as what appears to be a public park for the last 30 years. I think it would be all but impossible to put a facility on what people perceive as their open space in Metrotown.
I think the planning department gave us some feedback that there was part of that land set aside for some future uses.
But being set aside and the politics of the community allowing it to happen, I think, are two different issues.
Councillor Johnson, you did mention some other locations which have a lot of potential. We think it should be in a location that has good transit, a good population, a commercial area. That's where the people are. And Edmonds, Lougheed, Gilmore, Brentwood, those are all locations that could work.
Okay, fair enough. To follow up on Councillor Calandino, I would tend to agree. I think it's, in concept, a very supportable idea, but the concept of sustainable funding, and I mean day-to-day funding, money to get in different exhibits and different displays, remodeling of the interior and such, that's where your costs are, and that's the part that I think the city's a bit cautious on?
I think the operational part that some of these questions are around, once the facility is established, that can be addressed in the same kind of feasibility study. I mean, it's one more thing that has to be looked at as what are, you know, what
well,
are the
I'm
issues.
I'm sure they'll look at it. I'm sure look at it, but I can pretty much predict that it won't be a moneymaker. A swimming pool recovers 80. I mean, I'm not saying that you only build swimming pools, but a swimming pool recovers 90-something percent of its cost on an annual basis in revenue. An art gallery is going to be a net expenditure. There's very few in the world that actually break even.
We believe, we understand, for example, in North Vancouver, it includes, they have a portion that's in for meetings and weddings and events like that. So there's potential. Probably it couldn't recover all of its costs, but we think there's, in a facility that's properly designed and located, that there's a greater potential for cost recovery.
One of our members looked at some, I think we looked at four or five cities across Canada that had similar populations with standing gallery, contemporary gallery spaces, and majority of those facilities they looked at broke even. They were not losing money. Yes.
As opposed to Metro Vancouver, metropolitan area?
Yes.
I mean, I think that's part of our concern is we've got the big city next door with the big facility.
Right. But we're not really in competition. We're a different, this would be a different kind of facility for Burnaby. You've got some assets that City of Vancouver does not have. I mean, you've got a different kind of visitor population collection and so forth. So
it's a unique situation. We'll see what comes forward.
Okay.
Thanks.
I appreciate you being here. Is that we'll ask staff to respond to the delegation. As I say, the request to go into a major study in regard to this would require council being prepared to budget significantly more funds and more work to this project before we move forward. So I think what you should do is get a report from staff responding to what the delegation has indicated, and then at that point make a decision whether you want to move on to allocating tens of thousands of dollars to the studies that are proposed.
Your Worship, on the comments of the delegation, I would move that staff prepare a report on the advisability and feasibility of the potential of a public art gallery in Burnaby.
That would probably, their expectations are there would be a study as a result of that.
Well, Your Worship, I think the report will probably incorporate the remarks not only of the delegation here, but of the report that's presented here. So I you know, I'm not going to parse the language on it. I think staff has heard the comments of the delegation. I think we've all heard the comments of the delegation. There have been some issues raised. I'm sure staff can come back and give us their interpretation of what the delegation has presented.
Okay. As long as that, I didn't want to give them the impression that we were undertaking a study as a result of that. Councillor Dhaliwal.
Your Worship, I believe I've seconded the motion which is the study. Yeah. Moved, and I second it.
Yes.
So, staff, the clerk is shaking her head. I just wanted to read that, see what that motion is.
I have Councillor Volko.
Yeah.
And then McDonnell second.
Okay, either one. What's the motion?
The motion so far is that staff respond to the issues raised in the report submitted by the Burnaby Art Gallery regarding the feasibility of art gallery in Burnaby.
Feasibility and advisability.
And advisability.
Yeah. Thank you. That's clear. Thank you, Your Worship. First of all, I didn't have any question for the delegation because the documentation plus the presentation was pretty adequate. I wanted to take a moment to thank the Arts Council and particularly the people who are in the gallery for my many, many years sitting on the commission. I received these presentations. They had shown a great amount of discipline, also persistent, and their commitment to the arts, and I appreciate that, and I think that's what this is all about. And tonight, the similar presentation was made, and I think it's appropriate for us to get that report from the staff to see how we proceed to that point, to say, okay, we as a city, are we able to propose something that will work, both addressing the concerns of the mayor and the councillors that have been indicated, and how these things can be funded, what's available to us. And that cannot be done unless we have a staff really done some due diligence on this. And I think it's very supportable in terms of really getting to say, yes, let's listen to what the community has to say from the art side. We know there are concerns around both the capital cost and the ongoing cost, but the staff would be able to tell us what's appropriate, what's feasible, what is required. That's in the form of a needs assessment, Your Worship, and I will support that.
Thank you. All right, you ready for the question? All those in favor, opposed, and carried. Thank you very much for being with us tonight.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
All right, a motion to resolve into a committee of the whole to consider reports. Been moved and seconded. All those in favor, opposed, and carried. The first report is from the Executive Committee of Council, Councillor Dhaliwal.
Thank you, Your Worship. This is regarding the McKerchief Community Resource Center, Your Worship. Recommendations are that the Council approve the proposed remainder 2016 lease grant for the nonprofit tenant Burnaby Family Life on McKerchief Community Resource Center, as outlined in Section 4.0. And number two, that a copy of this report be forwarded to the Executive Director of Burnaby Family Life at Holdham Avenue. Your Worship, you will recall this is a facility, city-owned facility, that has been in existence for the last, I believe, since early 2000 when it opened. It is funded, it's actually managed through Burnaby Family Life, and this has been fairly supportive of the children, which really is about the early child support that we provide, Your Worship. The only difference is now on is that starting this March, Your Worship, this facility would also receive lease grant like other city-supported facilities are, where local non-profit organizations work out of, Your Worship. It used to be in a different arrangement, Your Worship. Going forward, we have included this McKerchief Community Resource Center to be just as the others are. That's my report, Your Worship.
All right, you ready for the question? All those in favor, opposed, carried. Next report also from Executive Committee.
Thank you, Your Worship. These are grant applications. First is item number 1610, Community Centered College for the Retired. A recommendation is that a grant in the amount of $1,500 be awarded to the Community Centered College for the Retired to assist with the cost of the courses and programs.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor, opposed, carried.
1611 is a home instruction for parents of preschool youngsters, Your Worship. The recommendation is that this grant request be denied.
Moved and seconded. Discussion? Seeing none. All those in favor, opposed, carried.
And next item is 16.12, which is Burnaby Community Services. A recommendation, Your Worship, is that a supplemental grant in the amount of $8,720 be awarded to Burnaby Community Services in support of the Recreation Credit Program for 2015.
Moved and seconded. Discussion? Seeing none. All those in favor, opposed, carried.
Item number 16.13 is the Canadian Ball Hockey Association. That a grant in the amount of $400 be awarded to the Canadian Ball Hockey Association for travel expenses of two Burnaby players to represent Canada at the 2016 World Ball Hockey Championships in Sheffield, England, on July 6th.
Discussion? Seeing none. All those in favor, opposed, carried.
Next report is also from the Executive Committee, Your Worship. On behalf of the committee, I move that a request from Scandinavian Culture Society that a festival Burnaby grant for neighborhood event and the amount of $2,500 rewarded to Scandinavian Culture Society for the Leif Erikson Day Festival to be held on October 15, 2016.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. All those in favor, opposed, carried.
Next item, 16N002, is Vancouver Intercultural Orchestra Society. Your Worship, the recommendation that this grant be denied. This grant request be denied.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. All those in favor, opposed, carried.
Next item, 16N003, Burnaby International Folk Dance Club. Your Worship, recommendation is that a festival Burnaby grant neighborhood event in the amount of $1,000 be awarded to the Burnaby International Folk Dance Club at the, I believe it's Lyriot's Folks Dance Festival to be held on April 22 to 24.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. All those in favor, opposed, carried. Thank you very much, Councillor Dhaliwal. Moving on to the City Manager's Report. Item 1 is a request for Council to bring forward a bylaw to appropriate $1,727,100 from capital reserves to finance the Caribou Hill School Park Artificial Turf Field Replacement Project. Been moved and seconded. Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, opposed, carried. This is authorization for the city to enter into an agreement with the Burnaby School District for the contribution to the cost of playground upgrades at Clinton Elementary School. Questions called. All those in favor, opposed, and carried. This is to provide Council with information regarding the partnership with Simon Fraser University to facilitate SFU's 50th anniversary Festival of Learning. Questions called. All those in favor, opposed, carried. This is to request Council to bring forward a bylaw to appropriate $1,463,330 from capital reserves to finance 9 projects in Parks, Recreation, and Cultural Services. Questions called. All those in favor, opposed, and carried. Item 5.
Recommendation
item 5. This is to obtain authority for the sale, for moving or salvage or demolition of the structures at 1522 Gilmore Avenue. Questions called.
I've got a question.
Oh, Councillor Volko.
I don't have a question. I have a comment just arising out of this. There's been reports in the press in the last week and a half in regards to some disreputable companies that go around removing asbestos prior to demolition of homes in the Lower Mainland. And I'm hoping that our staff, prior to letting the contract for this demolition, makes sure either checking with WorkSafe or the Better Business Bureau or anyone else that I haven't thought of, that whoever we assign to the demolition is in full compliance of all the WorkSafe requirements and regulations.
Yes, staff will make sure that it is.
Thank you.
All right, you ready for the question? All those in favor, opposed, carried. Item 6.
Move the 3 recommendations, item 6.
This is to present resolutions for submission to the 2016 Lower Mainland Local Government Association Annual General Meeting and Union of BC Municipalities Convention. Councillor Jordan.
Thank you, Worship. I just wanted to highlight a couple of the new resolutions that we'll be putting forward this year. The first one coming out of our Community Development Committee was a resolution to encourage through UBCM by LMLGA to standardize a provincial approach to tenant assistance and items under the Residential Tenancy Act. And as the staff have written the background information in support of this resolution, what we're trying to do, and I've also spoken to my colleagues in Metro Vancouver Housing Committee about this, is get the province to up their game, shall we say, in the area of regulations under the Tenancy Act. And when there are, unfortunately, demolitions of properties affecting tenants, that so that we can have a standardized approach to how those regulations are applied around the region and increase the very minimal rules that are there at the provincial level now. So most of the cities, as this report talks about, have increased their bylaws and rules, but still we're ending up with a mixed quilt of things across the region. And in Vancouver, it's 6 months for this many years, and we're 3 months, and somebody else is 2 months, and it's like we really need a standard, and we need the provincial government to have a much higher standard than is currently there under the Residential Tenancy Act. So that's what that resolution is about. And then also, as per the work that this council has done over the last couple of years around the payday loan regulations, we're asking through this resolution to strengthen the regulatory framework for payday loans. And I understand also from ACORN, which is the group that brought this to us in the first place at the city level, that they're using our model now, our bylaw that we passed as a model when they're speaking to cities all across the country. So I heard for the first time ever Hamilton actually adopted some processes, not a full bylaw, but some processes around regulating payday loans in their community. So they're using our city's bylaw as a model for other cities, but we still need additional provincial regulatory framework and federal as well.
It's interesting how that never makes it into the paper, though.
No, well, there you go. I try.
No, other things about ACORN criticism do make it into the paper, but the fact they're using our tenant assistance program as a model is it somehow gets missed. Ready for the question? All those in favor, opposed, and carried. This is to provide council with information on proposed changes to provincial liquor policy. Councillor Dhaliwal.
Thank you, Your Worship. Thanks to the staff, first of all, coming back with a pretty quick report, because earlier last month we had just submitted this to the staff for a response. It took a fair amount of analysis of the proposed changes, Your Worship. As a result, we have a number of recommendations, or at least the concerns, that the staff has identified. All those are obviously in order to make sure that our current policy for both the serving liquor as it is done in the community are reasonably balanced, both with the needs and from both public security and well-being perspective, Your Worship. So thank you to staff. I just have one recommendation to make, Your Worship. I understood that this request was, although it did come through UBCM, however, it was from the LCLB, I believe. That's where the response should go to, with a copy to UBCM. I would like the staff to confirm, but I want to make a recommendation, change or add, make the amendment that, Your Worship, that this should be directed to Liquor Control Licensing Board, because they are the one who are seeking the feedback. UBCM was merely getting the word out that the response is due soon. So that with that change, Your Worship, I support the recommendations.
Mr. Pilche, are we responding directly to the Provincial Liquor and Licensing Board?
I think the suggestion from the councillor doesn't create any harm. It's probably a good benefit.
Don't we amend the resolution to say that this be submitted to the Liquor Control and Licensing Board, and that a copy of the report be sent to the Union of BC Municipalities?
So amend, Your Worship, yes.
All right. So it's been a motion to amend. All those in favor, opposed, and carried. And on the motion as amended, all those in favor, opposed, and carried. Thank you, Councillor Dhaliwal. All right, moving on then. To update status of Burnaby's application to BC Hydro for underground wiring funding assistance, and to seek council authorization to pursue the priority project on Edmund Street for 2016-2017. Councillor Dhaliwal.
Yes, thank you, Your Worship. I just wanted to confirm that the numbers were right on this one, Your Worship, from the staff. From what I decipher from this report is that approximately 30 meter of the work will be done from Canada Way towards Edmonds Fire Hall. That's about 30 meters, I understand, from the report. And the cost is expected to be, estimated cost is expected to be around $481,000. And I'm not certain whether I got it wrong or it's a different, some numbers, but if that's the case, I would, I'm...
Let me get the right area for you, because Mr. Moncur has just pointed out this goes from Canada Way to 30 meters past the fire station, so...
Oh, this is not a total length?
No, it's a longer stretch from Canada Way to pass the fire station, which is all public property from Canada Way through till past the station.
Much better. I feel a little better about this one, but I don't know how much this is, but it seems still be around $500,000, I think, for maybe a block and a half or something like that, if that, right?
Yeah. The estimate, Mr. Moncur has pointed out that it's probably more like 300 meters than 30 meters, but no denying it's expensive, and that's why we don't underground all of these wires all across the local municipalities, is because it's so expensive.
Well, that hence the concern, Your Worship. I'm not sure where to go with this one, but I certainly want to raise with the staff at this point, because I like to make some further inquiry, or at least what's happening across the metro in our region. From both from the engineering and planning perspective, whether these costs seems to be reasonable. I find that so enormous amount of cost, even for 300 meters, to have something like a $500,000 cost. Just wanted to understand a bit more. I'm not going to oppose this recommendation. We'll go with this, but I just want to alert the staff that I have some concerns with this, and if there is going to be ever any chance of us undergrounding, which I think should be, because the way right now the power is going off and all that, in every time there's some little bit of wind, the next thing you know, the wires are torn down and the staff is occupied then by recovering the power asset and all that. I certainly would like to see in the longer run, if you're going to undertake a much wider area to underground these powers, we need to figure out some way to mitigate these ultra high costs, Your Worship.
Thank you. Why don't I just ask staff to provide a memo? They can inquire from Hydro as to exactly why it's so expensive to underground wires and provide some background information, and then you can make a decision on how you want to pursue it.
Thank you.
Right.
That sounds good.
Councillor Johnson.
Just to follow up on your comments, you were saying
it would be interesting to see what happens in our neighboring city of New Westminster, where they have a city-run electrical utility versus BC Hydro. I think it would be interesting to see whether costs are comparable or whether we, as BC Hydro customers, are helping to pay off their deficit.
I don't know. I think they sell their electricity into the hydro system, don't they?
They buy it from Hydro, yes, but they then remarket it. So it would be interesting to see what they do.
Just
on a comparable basis.
You ready for the question? All those in favor, opposed, and carried. Item 9. This is three apartment towers with street-oriented townhouses, Brentwood Town Center plan, and this is authorization to forward to a public hearing on March the 29th. Ready for the question? Oh, Councillor Dhaliwal.
Yes, thank you, Your Worship. I thought maybe there was a typo, or maybe I misread that on page 79. It's report suggests there's a total of 802 apartment units, which I believe a total apartment units are 741. Yes, there are 802 units total, including townhouses, but that might be a typo. I just wanted to maybe bring it to the attention of the staff, whether I'm wrong or maybe the staff.
Pelche, have you caught up with that?
Page 79, Your Worship, second paragraph starts with a total of 802 apartment units.
Right.
And if you look at the report on page 84, apartment units are 741. Now, including the all units, if you add 61 units, which are townhouses, yes, it's 802. But the report says 802 apartment units and 61 units, so I just wanted to bring that up.
Yeah. On the same line, Your Worship, the two figures are there. The 802 units are in the apartment, and then later on in that same line is the 61 for the townhouse units.
But the report says otherwise at the back.
Oh, okay.
Page 84.
So we'll need to correct section 4.5.
All right. So you'll get that corrected before we end up at the public hearings. All right. With that noted, you ready for the question? Oh, Councillor Jordan.
Thank you, Worship. I just wanted to speak briefly this proposal and the next one, because there's a lot of discussion in the region that councils should regulate sizes and things of apartments. And I can see by this report and the next one, which is another additional to towers, that in both these projects, more than 10% of the apartments will be three stories or more, or three bedrooms or more. So people are talking about saying, oh, you must have 10% of three-bedroom apartments for family supportive and things. But in both these projects, even though we don't have a regulation at this point in time, I know our staff encourages the developers and things to work on them, but in this particular project, 88 of those 800 will be three bedrooms or more, and in the next one, Station Square, it's even a bigger percentage. It's over 100 out of 750 units will be three bedrooms or more. So that's, you know, that's a good thing. That is all.
That's right, and the marketplace is reflecting that need. In fact, the developers have told me that they have often been approached by people to put together two of the apartments in the buildings they were building prior to this, looking to expand the bedrooms. So they're answering that in the market by building units now that have two and three bedrooms more frequently. So we're seeing more and more people choosing to raise their families in high-rise developments as much different than it was in the past. All right, you ready for the question? All those in favor, opposed, carried. Item 10, this is Station Square Development, Phases 3 and 4, Metrotown Town Center. Authorization to forward to a public hearing on March the 29th. Second. Moved and seconded. Discussion. All those in favor, opposed, carried. Item 11. This is the expansion of Bridge Studios. And this is authorization to forward the application to a public hearing on March the 29th. This is good news. This is expansion of one of our movie studios, and that means more work here in Burnaby and potentially more of the tremendous television shows and movies that are produced here in Burnaby. So I always like to see these expanding. Ready for the question? All those in favor, opposed, carried. This is Riverbend Business Park, Phase 1. This is to seek authorization to forward the application to a public hearing on March the 29th. Councillor Dhaliwal.
Your Worship, I just have a question for the staff in terms of the just the city's protection right-of-way, et cetera, at the river's edge. From the development perspective, Your Worship, I was unable to decipher whether there is how much space has been reserved for future use of public as a trail or a roadway going towards east towards New Westminster, etc. I was in the wasn't sure from this report, Your Worship. I know it's in there somewhere, but I can't really figure this out. So I was wondering if the director can just clarify that, how much space is there between the river, et cetera, to the publicly accessed space before the private property ends.
Sure, Your Worship. The property will provide a 30-meter riparian setback from the Fraser River that will be planted and provide that function. Within that, there is a public accessible trail, typically a 2-meter wide compact gravel surface that will run east to west across the entire frontage of the property. And then they're building the urban trail up the old Wheaton right-of-way back to Riverbend Drive around on, as part of a subsequent phase from the riverfront up to the top of the property at Riverbend Drive as well.
The Riverbend Drive is on the north end of the property, correct?
Yes.
But I was questioning about the south side of the property, which would be the towards the shore of the river.
That will contain a public pathway,
which is a 30-meter riparian, which does that mean that it's still owned by the by the property, or is that then completely 30 meters of that is acquired for future public access completely?
It remains owned by the property. The city obtains rights of access for the public across the property on the new trail, and we protect the riparian covenant, the riparian area through covenant on the property as well.
Your Worship, I should express my concerns here. I had probably envisioned it wrong. I had thought there was going to be right next to the Fraser River shore from New Westminster side to Vancouver, eventually a greenway, some sort of connecting, which would be more than 2 meters at any spot. I would have thought that perhaps there was going to be enough, such as a minimum of, let's say, 5, 6 or some meters, which allows the vehicle and other things to pass as the city would desire to. But I imagine that's not the case.
Yes, it's certainly not intended for vehicles on the waterfront. So the 30 meters really provided into an open space zone on the property that's able to be enjoyed by the public, but the access across the waterfront is pedestrian and cycle movements, not vehicle movements.
I don't think anywhere along that route we've intended to access vehicles. It's bikes and pedestrians, and it's public access, and it's protection is the major thing. So the riparian area accomplishes that purpose for us because it's covenanted, so they can't do anything on it except ensure that it remains protected.
Thank you, Your Worship, but I didn't mean the public vehicle, access to vehicle. I meant that if there was a service vehicle was required as such from the city, because it's a dike there and all that going to be, that there was going to be enough right-of-way for us all the time, for the city to be that. I thought that would be a plan for us to acquire the shore right in that sense, rather than having just a walkway for folks. In situations like this, it would seem to me that if it was some reason we need to get there from city perspective, that this probably perhaps isn't enough to just rely on a public property and their sort of goodwill to let cities do those things. Perhaps a memo of staff could do on this one, see if that is the case all the way through. I had thought that wrongly, obviously, in this case, that there was going to be a more or less a connection, which would be like sort of a greenway on the north shore of the river.
There is, and that's the riparian area. The 30 meters is the protected area that is left for the public enjoyment, but it's still owned by the property, but it is protected by covenant, as is often the case. It's protected by covenant and gives us public right-of-way through that area. And I don't know about whether or not if we need to do any work on the bank of the river, would that access be permitted?
In this case, the diking function for this property falls within the responsibility for the property owner and is something that's regulated through the planning, the engineering process, as well as the Ministry of Dikes that has a say on the design of that facility. So they're building, designing, and have obligations to maintain that flood protection on that bank for the broader public interest in that area. And other parts in the Big Bend, the city owns the land, and we've taken responsibility for those dikes. But when there's a dike on a private property, they're responsible to build and maintain that to an appropriate standard, and we assure that all the legal requirements to that regard are in place through the rezoning and subdivision.
All right. Ready for the question? All those in favor, opposed, and carried. Item 13. This is the building permit tabulation report from January 1st to 31st, 2016, and this provides information on construction activity. Right. Questions called? All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Item 14. This is to award a contract for the renovation of office space for the Information Technology Department at Deer Lake Center. Question. Questions called? All those in favor? Opposed? And carried. Item 15. This is to obtain council approval to award a construction contract for the combined sewer separation program on Graham Avenue. Ready for the question? All those in favor, opposed, and carried. Motion that the committee rise and report. All those in favor, opposed, and carried. Motion to adopt the report of the committee. All those in favor, opposed, and carried. Bylaws, Councillor Jordan.
Thank you, Worship. For this week's bylaws, I move for first, second, and third reading, I move that Burnaby Capital Works bylaws number 13574 and 13575 be now introduced and read three times.
Second. Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, opposed, carried.
For consideration and third reading, I move that Burnaby Zoning Bylaw 13471 be now reconsidered and read a third time.
Okay. It's been moved and seconded. All those in favor, opposed, and carried.
For consideration and third reading, I move that Burnaby Zoning Bylaw 13471 be now considered and read a third time.
It's been moved and seconded. All those in favor, opposed, and carried.
For third reading, reconsideration, and final adoption, I move that Burnaby Zoning Bylaw 13288 be now read a third time, reconsidered, and finally adopted, signed by the mayor and clerk, and the corporate seal affixed thereto.
Second. Moved and seconded. Discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, opposed, carried.
And for reconsideration and final adoption, I move that Burnaby Zoning Bylaws 13154, 13410, 13421, and Burnaby Capital Works Bylaws 13572 and 13573 be now reconsidered, finally adopted, signed by the mayor and clerk, and the corporate seal affixed thereto.
Second motion. Been moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor, opposed, and carried.
I think we should have like Academy Awards for who does the best bylaw reading.
Why don't I just give it to you now?
Well, it's kind of like, you know, the flight instructions about doing your seatbelt up on the plane and stuff every time.
All right, new business. Under new business, Councillor Jordan.
Just in the purple pages, there's a quite lengthy letter from Minister Fassbender in response to our call for freezing the assessed values of houses because of the tremendous growth in our region, especially here in Burnaby and Vancouver in the last year. And the minister is going to be very happy to work with our staff to do anything else but raise the assessed values, I think is what the two pages say. But it's interesting, he does comment that they did increase the maximum thresholds for the grant, and that is true. And he comments that 91% of the homes in the province will fall below this threshold, and that is true, but our own staff have told us in this city that only 81 percent of our homes will fall below that threshold. So it's there's a large gap between the number of folks in Burnaby who are going to miss out on the gap and the average target that the province aims for around the province. So I've been working with our staff in the finance department. All of this pertains to not our part of the tax bill, but the school tax part of the tax bill. Right? So the grant is in relation to the school tax. The school tax, we just found out the numbers last week in the provincial budget, so we're working with staff to try to get a sense of, how shall I refer to it, the inequity of this method of funding schools, the inequitable distribution of how that tax is collected around the province, the inequitable apportionment of the grants, because I don't know how many people would be aware, but did you know that West Kelowna is considered a rural area, and people in West Kelowna get a larger grant than people in Burnaby because West Kelowna is rural? And I think her name is Ms. Clark.
Oh, right? No.
Anyway, it's been that way for a long time, but I was dumbfounded to see that West Kelowna, which has now become a city, is considered a rural area. So anyway, we're working on some further information on this and appreciate the minister's response, at least to our letter. Sometimes we don't even need to get a response.
I think more and more people in the Lower Mainland are becoming aware, and the politicians in the Lower Mainland are becoming aware of the incredible unfairness there is in regard to taxation between property taxpayers in the Lower Mainland and property taxpayers throughout the rest of British Columbia. The government tends to highly favor municipalities outside the Lower Mainland, and meanwhile, they gain significant revenues out of the Lower Mainland area. We carry a bigger and bigger burden in regard to costs for local taxpayers, and I'm really pleased we're doing more research at that level at Metro Vancouver, here and other areas, to begin focusing on what is fair and how do you get to the point where we start to confront those issues. One of the problems we always have had is that the UBCM is largely representative of the rural municipalities in British Columbia. So two-thirds of the municipalities are much smaller and they carry the largest percentage of membership, and yet half the population of British Columbia is here in the Lower Mainland and vastly underrepresented. So that is where the problems come, is sometimes UBCM isn't exactly the best organization to lobby for us on those issues. They have an inherent conflict of interest and are not necessarily that desirous of chasing this down, given that it will affect two-thirds of their membership. So, you know, we have to keep pushing these issues, but I'm glad we're making it more clear, because you're seeing more and more of school taxes coming out of the Lower Mainland. Certainly the property transfer tax, which occurs down here, is largely, you know, supporting the government as opposed to the monies that are taken in regard to other municipalities across British Columbia. So this latest new home, $750,000 and under proposal, probably serves all of the hinterland of British Columbia, but not many places here in the Lower Mainland. So I think it's good that we're chasing this down, and as we begin to pull the layers off this onion, we start to discover there's more to make you cry. All right, you ready for the, oh, we don't need a question on it, is that we are a new business. So anything else? Right, I have one final announcement, and this is one that, you know, it's one of those bittersweet kinds of announcements, because you're congratulating someone on their freedom, but at the same time, you're in a position where you really are going to desperately miss their effort and wisdom. I have an announcement today that is very significant to council, to staff, and all of our citizens. After 30 years of exceptional service to our city, City Manager Bob Moncur has announced his retirement. As all Burnaby City staff and the citizens of Burnaby know, Bob is an exemplary leader. It is under his guidance, direction, and stewardship that our city over the past 30 years has grown to become a thriving metropolis that has been recognized as the best-run city in Canada and has received innumerable additional honors that speak to Burnaby's many enviable attributes achieved with Bob at the helm. I know that Bob is stepping away from his role as Burnaby's city manager with mixed emotions as he is leaving behind a city that, in large part because of his leadership, is vibrant, welcoming, and financially sound. But he is also saying farewell to exceptional staff and colleagues who have worked alongside him to ensure the city's plan comes to fruition. Together with staff, citizens, and councils, many councils in fact, and at least three mayors, Bob has been a leader and steward in the building of a city that offers exceptional services to citizens while protecting green space and keeping taxes low. It's not surprising that Bob says he has found his career here to be personally and professionally rewarding. He has achieved great success and formed many strong personal relationships that we know he'll take with him when he retires. What is also noteworthy, however, is that he doesn't take credit for the work he has done. He always attributes the city's many successes to the council, staff, and citizens he's worked with to realize Burnaby's goals and aspirations. And he often speaks of the great pleasure he has found in working with exceptional people throughout his career. Bob says that his personal success is firmly rooted in his practice of hiring competent people, mentoring them, and letting them loose to do what they were hired to do. I think that reflecting on Bob's 30 years of success, council can claim the same sort of victory. Our success over many years has much to do with hiring Bob. Bob's last day as in the manager's chair will be February 29th. I personally am going to miss Bob's presence here at the city along with his advice and leadership, and I know that Burnaby staff and citizens will miss him too. Bob and I over the years have been personal friends. In fact, our kids grew up together in hockey and remain very close friends to this day. And Bob has always lived in the city of Burnaby and been a part of our community and understood the issues not only from the perspective of a senior bureaucrat, but also from the perspective of a resident and a citizen in our community. He also volunteered significant amounts of his time to our local community efforts. It wasn't unusual to see Bob down operating the time clock at Copeland in order to ensure that we had the right amount of people working on any hockey night. So tonight, as we will do several times over the next few months, as various groups wish Bob well and celebrate his achievements, please join me and Burnaby City Council in wishing Bob the very best in his retirement. While we will miss his day-to-day leadership, we continue to enjoy and build upon its outcomes. On behalf of staff, citizens, and council, thank you, Bob, for your dedication to the city of Burnaby and for the invaluable legacy your leadership leaves with us. We wish you a wonderful retirement, and we will obviously be having an event to help Bob celebrate his newfound freedom in retirement and the opportunity to pursue many of his other hobbies. And I know that Bob certainly is a traveler, and there'll be much opportunity for him to see more of the world. But I can tell you, Bob, without a word of a lie, that we are truly going to miss you, and I personally am going to really miss your advice. So thank you, Bob. And there are a few comments, I imagine, from councillors. Councillor McDonnell.
Thank you, Your Worship. Yes, I'd like to add to what you had to say in recognition of Bob's service. When you look at the title, it says it all, but most people don't understand what the title says. It says manager, and the manager is responsible for the day-by-day operation for the staff that are underneath them, and that to keep the city operating on an even keel and in the best interest of the citizens. We get elected, so you get councils and mayors that come and go because the people decide, but the city manager sits here, and he is the person that is the stabilization force for the city when we go through a transition at any time with a mayor or big change in council, something like that, and has to guide the city during that time. Excuse me. I guess the best way I would describe Bob is to say that he is the epitome of what a city manager is and how a city should be run, and you commented that we did get the award being the best managed city in Canada, and that's the responsibility of a city manager to manage. And for that, Bob, thank you very much.
Councillor Dhaliwal.
Thank you, Your Worship. What I have to say has been already said, but I believe it's worth repeating anyway because I wanted to say those things myself as well, Your Worship. As you said, a leader at the helm of a city like ours requires a fair amount of commitment to make sure that things happen here in a way that both are workable with the council as well as the citizens as well as the staff. He had a dual responsibility, one to the citizens and also to the council. So that's not an easy task to do for anyone. So I think you need a special type of personality, skills to do that. We often hear about people, Your Worship, in many councils where there's a headbutting goes on between the council and the staff, a mayor and the staff, etc., and all that. How often you've seen people being let go, etc., and all that at that position. We're very fortunate to have someone like Bob, who has been here for obviously 30 years providing that leadership, and we've never been in that position where we had to second guess the kind of staff we had. So that's a great, as far as I'm concerned, a talent of someone like Bob who has done over the last three decades, Your Worship. As far as where the city is, I believe, as you know, Your Worship, you've been here all that time since Bob been here. The city had changed a lot if you look back 30 years. The town centers, the way we have acquired 20% of our land base, where we are in financially, Your Worship, where we are in the facilities. And most importantly, the way the public rates us, our citizens talk about how well the city is being managed in terms of our response. Oh yes, there is always concerns about the taxes, etc., but when people really look down to say what they receive in return and the quality of life that exists in our city, that is because a leadership that comes from the staff that day in, day out, that they make sure that the policy of the council are carried out, that they are in sync with the public, and they're also in sync with in terms of where the city is going to go. Your Worship, I have a great admiration for our staff all along. I know they do a wonderful job, but it's Bob's name ultimately when I receive reports. Every report that comes from the staff is a Bob's name at the bottom of it, which I believe Bob looks at them very seriously because I put him to test many times on these ones, because then I know he has a response because they've seen it and things just didn't fly in because it's a report is due, let's get it out. So I know how much work has been done. I know how much commitment has been made to that. So, and that is bodes well for someone like who is a city manager who feels that we have responsibility, Your Worship. So we are better for, as a city, for someone like Bob, so we appreciate the work that you've done. On a personal note, Your Worship, as you said, I have a great admiration for the leadership, guidance, and sometimes just opinion that I've received from Bob on many of the policies, many of the things, and that has helped me grow into my position because I've been only here for half the time Bob's been here. So that has helped me bet. And also, he's my buddy in generally at the Burnaby Minor Hockey Tournaments. We do the time clock for the last, I don't know, two decades or three decades. Bob's not only just a city manager, Worship, he's out there in the community. I recall him and Bob and I both served on the executive of Burnaby Miners, and I guess it was probably 100 years ago. But it was, we did that together. And that's in spite of his commitment here, Your Worship, he managed to find time. I know this job is very demanding. It's just as demanding as yours because this is not just just one department, but all the 2,500 employees, what they do. Bob has to be responsible for that. And he found time to really work in the community as well, Your Worship. So for that, He figures this city is not just a job, it's this is community, and that's how he took it. So we were very fortunate to have you, Bob. Thank you for the work that you've done for the city. Appreciate it.
Councillor Kane.
Thank you, Worship. I don't want to miss this opportunity to really say thank you to our wonderful city manager. When I was first elected to council, I was like, wow, I'll be working with the mayor, that's awesome, and seven councillors. But when I saw Bob came into the room and the way he spoke, I'm like, wow, I actually get to work with the city manager. So he, to me, is like this wonderful friend. He is a walking encyclopedia. You could ask him a question, he would not blink. He'll stand up and he'll tell you exactly the facts, the numbers, the years, whatever we need to know. So he's a great advisor. And to that, working with him for the past 8 years, when you were away, Your Worship, and I had to be acting, I had all the confidence that Bob would be able to carry me through all that. And when he told me it wouldn't be a problem, and you'll do great, I believed in him because I knew he was going to be just right beside me. But he's not just a person, a staff that we have here, but he's also a great friend. And I came to realize that when we went on our trips to Asia and to make friendship cities, is that he had great curiosity, and not only was he there, but he had great questions, and he did a great study abroad. And one of the fun times that we had in our off times was he had great comments on different types of wine. He's a connoisseur of good food. So that is something that he will be able to pursue more of when he is retired. Bob, we will really miss you. And I know you will always be watching Cable 4 and watching us in our debates, because you will miss us as well. So we love you very much, Bob. And and not only will he be watching, sometimes he will be back. So, Bob, thank you so much for all your years of service. I learned so much from you, and it was my honor to be serving with you as one of your youngest counselors here and to also have your support. So thank you so much, Bob.
Councillor Johnson.
Thank you, Your Worship. Your comment about several mayors is true. When I was first elected in 1993, Mr. Moncur, I believe, was the Director of Community Services, Administrative and Community Services. And I think that was a really a title that's grown with him in the city manager's job. He doesn't just do his day-to-day tasks at the city hall. You'll run into Mr. Moncur at Canada Day, walking his dog, or the Baccalaureate Wine Festival, or other community events, Hard House, or various community events, where he's there on behalf of himself as a private citizen. I think he's done a great service for the city of Burnaby, and I wish him well in a long retirement.
Councillor Calandino.
I thank you, Your Worship. I don't know if there's much more left to say, but I have to add that Bob is not just a manager, he's a brilliant Renaissance man. And I have direct experience with him, because when I first got elected, and I make my own wine, and I think I make good wine, but a little I knew that Bob was obviously a wine collector and a wine connoisseur, and he's been to the greatest and best wine cellars of the world. So I gave him a bottle of my aged white wine, and a week later or so I asked him what he thought of it, and of course he told me. Gave me the acidity level, gave me the aroma level, everything you could want to know, but so I didn't give him any more after that. but he didn't criticize it, he enjoyed it too, but he told me the things that were not special about the one I thought was special. but aside from that, I think that the wealth of knowledge that he has about every item of business that we have for the city is just amazing. His memory of steel is always something that I envy. And to give another example, I was on the labor relations, and when I had to do some labor relations things, I would go to Bob, and Bob didn't have to go to his shelves and pull out the book. He knew everything out of memory. He knew the clauses, he knew the contracts, he knew everything. And I think that most of the other administrators around Greater Vancouver would use Bob as a sounding board whenever there was bargaining to do. He was the most respected administrator, and obviously still is, in Greater Vancouver in terms of labor relations, and somebody to be admired, and personally somebody that I envy because he's such knowledge, such great memory, and as we age we tend to lose a few memory cells, and I'm one of those. But it just has been a superb administrator in Burnaby, and as you said, another councillor said, Burnaby is in the great condition we are today because of the hand of Bob Moncur at the top, at the leadership level for the city. So thank you very much, Bob. We will miss you, but I'm sure that you're looking forward to your various travels and wineries and restaurants around the world.
Councillor Jordan.
Thank you, Worship. I'll be very brief, and I just echo everything that everyone else has said around the table, but adding one more piece to the puzzle, and that's your lovely wife, Reggie, because they're quite a team. And I'm sure a highlight of your 30-year career, if you added up all of the buffets that you've attended and all of the banquets, and Reggie has come along with you to all of those, and again representing the city on international visits and travels and things, you know, the two of you have been real ambassadors for us in that respect, and also you know, a part of the social life of what it is to be a community. So I wanted also acknowledge her role in your partnership and her contribution to the city, and I'll give you my phone number to give to her, so when she's having trouble dealing with a retired husband, she can phone me up, because I have experience at that too. So thank you very much, Bob.
All right, that concludes all of the speakers. Now an opportunity for Bob Moncur to just reply. That's right. He doesn't often put a light on.
I wanted to see what it said when I pushed it. Thank you, Your Worship, and thank you to all of council. I'm probably not usually at a loss for words, but I feel a little bit that way tonight. And although it's me retiring, and so the focus has been a little bit more on me than I would appreciate, but as the mayor said, it's through every working relationship we've had, through the staff, through the mayor and council, and through my relationship with them, that we've accomplished what we have. And it truly is a team effort, and I've been very, very fortunate to have the mayor and council, or the mayors and councils that I've worked with, and to have the staff I've worked with, many of whom were here before I got here, and I've been here 30 years. So it's really a reflection of what kind of a place Burnaby is and what kind of a place it is to work, that so many staff have come and stayed as long as they have, and I think we've been able to accomplish a lot. And as I meet with other city managers, I frequently tell them how lucky I am as a city manager, that my relationship with the mayor especially and council is the way it is, that I've never had a mayor who wanted to be the manager, and needless to say, I haven't wanted to be the mayor, but we've been able to, I think, you know, truly sort out the difference between what's administrative work that we as staff do, and what's the policy work and the public work that the mayor and council do. And as Sav said, we haven't been butting heads very often, other than professionally in terms of making decisions, but there's a lot of respect that I have for every one of you around the table, and the work you do and the time you spend doing it. You know, I spend quite a bit of time as the city manager, but it pales in significance to the amount of time that all of you as councillors and as the mayor especially spend in doing the job for the city. And so a lot of people said to me today, so this is your last council meeting. I said, well, it's my last council meeting on this side of the table. So I might be sitting out there someday in the future. I may be watching on Channel 4. Is it still on Channel 4? I might have to watch on the internet. But anyways, I will certainly miss Burnaby. It is truly mixed emotions. But I thank you all for the relationship we've had and the support you've given me, and to all of the staff. And I thank all of the staff through you to the efforts they've made and the accomplishments we've had. So we've done it together, and thank you very much.